So at the outset, I think these are all fun debates to have, and we need to clarify that there is no one shoe that fits all. We need to be careful about what kind of arguments we make. With that, I had written originally against, but I removed that. I said we'll just think about SLT as a first line of therapy in early and moderate glaucoma. What did I do? Which is the next slide? What I will talk about is, there is a lot of literature to say that SLT is as good as ALT. Why not ALT, why SLT? I have a problem with using SLT in early glaucoma. As what is the definition of early glaucoma and when do you want to use it? Anything new and expensive, all of us are very fond of. And there are complications as opposed to against what Krishnadas just told you. So there are a lot of studies throughout literature that continue to say that SLT is no better than ALT when the outcome measure is intraocular pressure control and when the outcome measure is repeatability. If you look at those two things, those electron micrographs that he showed of the damage produced by ALT and no damage produced by SLT, there is only one photograph. And every single speaker keeps on showing that photograph only. I don't know who studied, when they published it. So when we go honky-dory about that kind of a thing, we need to actually step back and see where is it coming from, what does it actually mean. If on the ground, all these studies show that SLT has equivalent efficacy to ALT with a similar constellation of side effects, in the case of retreatment, SLT appears to be similar to ALT in IOP lowering at 6 months. That's a meta-analysis of looking at all the literature. SLT is as effective as argon laser trabeculoplasty and medications in reducing IOP in glaucoma and ocular hypertension. The treatment is not uniformly effective in all eyes, and its IOP lowering effect decreases over time. So it just depends upon which side of the coin you want to look at. And this review talks about SLT is same as ALT. 360 degrees of SLT is equal to medical therapy. Latanoprost is better than 90 or 180 degrees of SLT. And there is a new laser, excimer laser trabeculoplasty, which is supposed to be better than SLT. So when do you move from ALT to SLT and to excimer laser trabeculoplasty? A point that I will talk about subsequently. When you talk about treatment in moderate and severe glaucomas, whatever is the treatment, I'm okay. But when you talk about treatment in early glaucomas, I get scared. And this is one of my favorite slides. 50% on treatment do not have glaucoma. So in our eagerness to diagnose glaucoma early, and with the kind of methodology that you have with imaging and things like that, and less dependence on perimetry and more dependence on imaging, we actually are probably treating a lot of people who do not have glaucoma. And if you have invested in an expensive equipment and you want your return on investment, you end up probably doing more SLTs than what is actually required. So this is a 14-year-old girl in a developing country, nearby developing country, had discs like this. I'm sure 90% of us sitting in the room would not even investigate for glaucoma if you see a disc like that in a myo. She was investigated. Unreliable visual fields, and HRT shows some yellow areas. Corneal thickness is 487, and intraocular pressure is 19. So two risk factors of a lower corneal thickness and a borderline intraocular pressure within the normal limits, the patient ends up getting an SLT. So this is the kind of treatments that we will give if you want to do SLT in early glaucomas. From that context, actually, as I will tell you subsequently, most of what we practice will depend upon what the industry is aggressively marketing. So this is how they market. Would you consider OCT option, OCT optic nerve changes as an indication for glaucoma surgery, which can be SLT also, in the absence of visual field changes? So one of my counterparts in this argument says that when in doubt, the glaucoma surgeon should opt for surgery because IOP target and the fluctuations, like Krishnadas was saying, are achieved only by laser trabeculoplasty or surgery. Therefore, when OCT changes indicate that surgery is warranted, whatever is that reason, the patient should not be denied the benefits of the smart therapy here or an express implant in this article. And my response to that was, the basic premise of medical profession is above all, do no harm. If you are looking for surgical indications at earlier and earlier stages of the disease, we end up losing the patient for the eye for the glaucoma, glaucoma for RNFL thickness, and RNFL thickness for OCT. So the kind of jumps that we make, I think we need to be careful about. Then talking about anything new and expensive is what we are after. So this is an article that I came across where In 1981, it was shown that in an event of myocardial infarction, beta blockers and aspirin are the best treatment to give. And the compliance in the best case scenario was only 62% for both of them. So my question is, would this happen if the treatment in consideration was new, under patent and expensive? Because the industry will market it, we will follow it, not otherwise. So whether or not physicians believe in the accuracy of information provided, detailing is extremely effective at changing prescribing behavior or therapies, which is why it is worth its substantial expense. So this is the kind of graph that trabeculoplasty has gone through. I was thinking that it actually happened because the laser trabeculoplasty technique, selective laser, has changed hands and a new industry is actually investing more. But actually this is because the FDA approval was there. But what happened within my knowledge within India, each time a new vendor takes over the machine, they come across and say that I'm leaving a machine for you, please try. And then the marketing of selling it will come. How many of us are gung-ho about express implants now? Alcon doesn't want to invest in its marketing anymore, and we are not talking about it anymore. So I think what we do, it depends upon which is marketed aggressively. And if you're talking about smart selective laser trabeculoplasty now, you need to worry about microdiode laser trabeculoplasty, titanium sapphire laser trabeculoplasty, therapeutic ultrasound for glaucoma, and deep wave trabeculoplasty. All of them are coming. So when we change gears from the laser trabeculoplasty to one of these things is what you need to worry about. As far as complications are concerned, if you increase the number of indications and if the trabeculoplasty machine and the YAG laser are present in the same console, there are reports where there are foveal burns because the YAG capsulotomy was done with an SLT mode. Somebody did SLT, did not change the mode back, and YAG capsulotomy was done with that, and there have been case reports of where foveal burns were there. So I think it is as good as ALT. In early glaucoma, we need to be careful. Why not ALT in SLT? And anything new and expensive that is being marketed, how we introduce them into our practice is what we need to be careful about. There is nothing without complications in medicine. Remember that. Thank you.